Okay, welcome everyone here for the very sacred and precious service to honor the life of Jackie Turmel. Al's here, faithful husband, and the family, friends, people that knew Jackie, the French Quebec, French connection, the Maine, up in Maine, Quebec, Canada, that whole area, and Jackie's precious faith, meeting the ministry, meeting Dr. Stevens, and then just being so preciously loving and caring for God and his work. So we celebrate her life today. So we'll have a prayer. Lord, in our hearts, we honor this woman, her faith, her purity, her attitude, humility, her friendship, for this service. Bless everything we see and hear in memory of this saint who has gone to be with you. As all of us live this life for your glory, and she's gone to receive her reward, we celebrate her life today. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm going to do a lovely song, Blessed Assurance. Carol Ann rewrote a few of the words because we want you to think of it not from the perspective of what I'm hoping for, but the reality of what she has right now, her heavenly perspective.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what perfection and glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I with my Savior am happy and blessed. Forever at last I'm seated above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. So, dear family, though I could not
Okay, good afternoon. It is a good afternoon. As we are celebrating the life of Jackie Tramiel, who lived a life worth celebrating. And our condolences to Ron and Diane, Carol Ann, Pauline, who is in Florida watching, I assume. And then the patriarch, Mr. Al Tramiel, 96 years old. World War II vet. Thank you, sir. And the other day, last week, I think it was, I was visiting Mr. Tramiel, and we were talking about his, I think it was his pacemaker, and had it checked, and the doctor said he had 4 more years worth of the pacemaker. And I said, well, that gets you to the 100 mark. And he goes, oh, no. He goes, no. And on the wall is a big picture of Jackie right there next to his bed. He's looking at her, and he goes, no, not till 100. I want to go home, right? We really are celebrating her life because for those who knew her, probably most of us knew her, and some for many years, decades, she was just a very spirit-filled woman. At least every time I was with her, that's the way she was. And I wish we had the picture available to see them. I don't know if they were engaged or just got married, but it is the cutest picture of Al and Jackie Tramiel. When you look at that picture, you just stare at it and go, I can't believe those two. So I said, she looks like a movie star from the 40s. And then, was it you, Carolyn, that told me this story? They were somewhere, and someone approached them and wanted her autograph. And she goes, no, I'm not so-and-so, whoever that was. And she insisted. So she gave her autograph. And it was it's just so sweet. So she was, when you think of her, I don't know what comes to mind. Be good if we had the time to have a shout out from the audience what comes to mind when you think of her. But I just wanted to just refer to Romans chapter 16 because it's kind of like a preview of the Bema, of the rewards ceremony that will take place when we stand before the Lord. It's not regarding eternal destination, because all those who are there are saints and will be in heaven and then return to the earth. But in Romans 16, Paul lists a whole lot of people that he knew, And he gives greetings to all those people. But it's like he's mentioning, when he says their name, something positive about them. It's really cool to look at. He says, Phoebe, a servant, a helper of many, including me. Phoebe was probably the one that took the letter from Corinth to Rome. He mentions her first. A woman gets first mention. Ladies, how about that? Jackie, how about that? Then Priscilla and Aquila. Not Aquila and Priscilla, but Aquila, Priscilla and Aquila. I think she's mentioned first in most times when she's mentioned. Not sure, but I think it might be so. What is it about women who are filled with the Spirit, who serve God with all their heart? What is it about women who love Jesus? Think about that. Who was it that followed Jesus the most fervently? It was the women. They loved him. Jackie Tramiel loved the Lord. It was obvious. And even as recent as maybe it was last year, earlier this year, when you went to visit her, she would, first maybe she wasn't sure who you were, but then she would just go into worshiping Jesus mode. She was like a little girl. She'd walk around the house, then not walking so much, and she would sing. She would just sing. Her daughters would sing along with her, and she was as happy as can be. That was her heart being manifested so beautifully. He says, Mary, a hard worker on your behalf, to the believers in Rome, Andronicus and Junia, fellow prisoners, because you guys were in the next cell next to me, or maybe in the same cell, but he mentions them. He says, Urbanus, a fellow worker in Christ. Stachys, he just says, beloved. But any mention of anything was spiritual truth. It's what characterized them. And we think of what characterized Jackie. I don't know, what comes to mind? We can have a shout out, she wouldn't mind. When you think of Jackie, what comes to mind? Gentle, faithful, joyful, kind. I heard loving. It kind of sounds like all the fruits of the Spirit just coming out, because that's just who she was, not to mention her prayer life. Apelles, approved in Christ. Aristobulus, greet those in his family. Herodian, greet him. Narcissus, greet those believers in his family. And then these two, Tryphena and Tryphosa. They may have been, say some, twin sisters. Their names mean delicate and dainty. Paul says, be sure to say hi to delicate and dainty. Can you be delicate and dainty and serve God? It's followed up by workers in the Lord. So we see here that being delicate and dainty doesn't mean you can't work hard. Isn't that cool? So that was Jackie. Persis. This one is for Afruz. She was from Persia, and she worked hard in the Lord. Paul wanted to make sure he greeted these saints. And so many women in this list. It's really beautiful. Then there's Rufus. Greet him. There's a whole story that goes with Rufus, but for now, Rufus, greet him, chosen in the Lord, and his mother. And then Paul adds, and mine. Rufus's mother, I mean, everyone, every servant of God needs a mother, right? When you're traveling. And those people that God puts in our life that look after us, that provide for us, that are just there to make sure we're okay. They're the ones cooking and inviting and maybe saying something. You need some rest. Or here, take this. It'll help you. Or something like that. And Jackie was like that. If you went over to the house, there would be food set before you. The cup of tea, the cookies, and just an attitude of waiting upon you. Because she loved the Lord and she loved his people. We can say this in summary. Let's put her in here. I mean, it's not official, okay? So let's put this. Maybe Paul would say, and greetings to Jackie. She finished well. Oh, yeah, she finished well. Let's have a hand. She finished well. Hallelujah. Okay, so I would like to finish with this letter from Jason, who is Jackie's grandson. Now, he's not this tall. I don't know how tall he is. He's very big. But, yes, he's a grandfather. So, but when your grandfather is 96, then you can be a grandson and be 48. So this, he couldn't be here, but he asked that this be read, so I'm going to read this for him. As I sit here writing this, I need to reflect back on how fortunate I have been to have had so many great role models that have been filled with wisdom, compassion for others, and the biggest of hearts that just overflowed and filled others with love. I know it is not a very common thing to have my grandparents as long as I have, and still to this day at 48 years old, have a surviving grandparent in my Pepe. My kids have been fortunate, and even my own grandchildren, to have had these beautiful human beings in their lives, even if for a short time. Today we remember my grandmother, my Meme, a woman who lived a charmed life and someone who walked with the Lord in her daily life. What my Meme meant to me, she was the wisdom of generations before me. Good advice when needed, great understanding and warmth with tremendous support. She was the symbol of a successful marriage with a strong family bond that tied it together. My life experience with Meme was always met with smiles and hugs and the feeling of complete happiness. My Meme was a beautiful, kind, and caring Christian woman who loved her family more than life and treated friends and others with that family type of welcoming love. Although I have had so many influences throughout my life, my Meme has had one of the greatest impacts out of all of them. Now, with that comes much more. She would always be quick to give it to me straight if I was wrong. I can still hear her voice in my head, still now as an angel on my shoulder to help guide me still. She taught me to always find reasons to live and celebrate and to hold traditions close, but also to create them. There will always be a void in my heart where my Meme will be missed, but inside I still have all the love that she filled in me and my life that will be kept forever. Thank you, Meme, for the countless years you invested in me. I am who I am today because of you. I will spend the rest of my life celebrating you and the things I have learned from you. Love you always, your grandson, Jason. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon. I love this family. It's amazing just honoring you all today, and especially Jackie. And thank you for being here today. We're going to have right now a time of testimonies. We have several chosen, and I just want to think of Jackie for a minute. One thing, I always saw the graciousness of God on her life. I remember when she had her open heart surgery, which was a few years ago, and I remember calling her up and visiting her in the hospital, and she said these words. She goes, "I had no pain. God granted me no pain," and just her joy and her childlikeness when she spoke of Jesus was so endearing and encouraging. But we saw that, right? And we see that in Carolyn and Diane and Ronnie, of course. But Carolyn and Diane, these are like they could be in that same chapter, I think, the way they care for the family. It's really incredible. So we're going to welcome here to the stage Pastor Norton, please. Yes, and Joanne, of course.
Well, I have to agree with everything what's been said for Jackie, because love Jason's letter. It's perfect. Birthdays have always been very special to me, because when somebody's born, it's the expression of God's word in the flesh. And we celebrate birthdays, and then we go on into eternity. And I was looking back to see, how long have I known Jackie? Well, it was when my sixth child was born that I met her. And he was a month old, and we moved to Auburn, and he became the pastor of the Log Cabin Church. Next year, that would be 40 years ago. I noticed on the program that they were married in 1950. I was 5 years old. So we have a big family, and we celebrate birthdays, and the kids know that they're very special to me. And I love it, because when you see Jackie, every time she was praying for her family, all those years and beyond, and Jesus came to serve, not to be served. He came to serve you and me and Jackie and Al and all the families. And when you see anybody who met Jackie or met Jesus, same time. Thank you.
Just a few thoughts. 40 years ago, when we were in Auburn and Lewiston, I was quite a bit younger. And Al and Jackie were like pillars and still are.
Backbone of the ministry.
Yes. And, you know, when you're young, you're novice and you don't even know it. And I know Jackie and Al could see that in me at that young time, and they never said a word, they just prayed. Always were praying. And I honestly believe that God called them both to a ministry of prayer, just to pray for people. And right now, I believe she's with that great cloud of witnesses that are around us, and she's still praying, and Al still prays. And so that intercessory kind of prayer is a special calling from God, I believe, and they have it, and they've used it so beautifully. Back in Auburn, we used to have these fellowship suppers every month, and everybody would bring a dish. Jackie would always bring her rice pilaf. I've never been a fan for rice. I like potato, but when she made rice pilaf, I had all kinds of it. It was really, really good. She could take she could take the plane and make it exquisite, and that's what it was. And then my last thought is simply that the last time I saw Jackie, it was such a precious time to be with them, and just the, you know, when your mind fails, your heart is still very clear. And her heart was incredibly clear. All she could talk about was Jesus and how much he loved her. And Jackie, we love you, and we know you're still praying, and thank you very much.
That was perfectly said. Wow, thank you. Ronald, come on up here next, please.
How you doing?
Good, good to see you.
Good to see you. Hello, everybody. I want to thank you all for coming here as we gather together to honor the memory of my mom. Some of you know me, and for those who don't, my name is Ron, and I'd just like to say a couple of things about my mother, what she meant to me. At a very early age, my mother taught me the value of communication. When I was 8 or 9 years old, she used to take me with her shopping or to the bank or wherever she had to go. And one thing I noticed about her was an amazing ability that I didn't have at that young age. She could turn around anybody. If she was standing in a line or if she was waiting, rummaging through groceries in a store, if there was somebody next to her, she'd turn around and start talking to that person. And she didn't even know her. And she was like that. She could talk to anyone. And me, 8 or 9 years old, I was like, wow, I got to know somebody before I can talk to them, you know? But as I grew up, I realized I became more like that. And I started talking to people that I didn't even know. And I believe I have my mother to thank for that. And a separate note, in addition to great communication skills, my mom was able to teach me what a motherly love really is all about in an incident that occurred to me later on in life. When I was in my early 20s, I left Massachusetts and I moved to California. And meanwhile, my parents and the rest of the family moved to Baltimore. I lived in California for about, 33 years. And in the last year, 2010, I developed a strain of influenza flu virus and a bad case of pneumonia. And I was hospitalized in Sacramento, California. My family was 3,000 miles away. Well, my lungs gave out. They had to put me on a ventilator. That's when they do a procedure called a tracheotomy, where they cut a hole in your throat, put a tube in. The other end's connected to a ventilator so you can breathe even though your lungs aren't working. Well, that's what kept me alive. But the doctor wasn't sure how long I was going to live. So he called my mom and my dad and the rest of everybody there at the house in Baltimore and said, look, we don't know how long your son's going to live. If you want to come and see him, you better come now. And my mom was afraid of planes. She didn't want to get on a plane for anything. I mean, you couldn't drag her onto one of those things. But for me, she did it. Her and my sister Carol flew 3,000 miles all the way to Sacramento, California, where I was. In the hospital. And for my mom to do something like that, that's to overcome her fear of flying, just for me, that was really something for me. When I saw her in the hospital and I saw Carol, my spirits just lifted. And I think that is part of the reason why I made it through, because I was destined to die. And when I saw my family there, that gave me the added impetus to live and go on, I believe. And that's about all I just have to say. I want to say in closing that if my mom was alive today, if she was here today, she would not want us to mourn her. Rather, she would want us to celebrate the fact that she's now with God and Jesus in heaven. And when we leave, we'll be there too, and we'll all see each other. Thank you very much for coming. Take care of yourselves and your loved ones.
Thank you. Thank you, Ron. Okay, very good. Okay, now we're going to have Lori Simpkins, please.
I'm here representing a very special person to all of us, so I wanted to just say a little bit about that person who I'm representing for her mom, and that's Pauline. A lot of you know Pauline. She's just amazing. And one thing I want to say about Jackie, one thing you can know about a mom is to see her children. And I can say personally, I've known them for years and years and years, and they're just so amazing, faithful, loving. The way Jackie was is the way they are. And Pauline has been serving God in Florida with her husband faithfully for years. And right now, just continue to pray for her, because a lot of you know she had a liver transplant, and she's doing amazing, and it's because of God and all your prayers. So thank you. So please continue. We love you, Pauline. So this is from Pauline. And I just wanted to say another thing. I worked with Jackie for many years, and it was when she was in her 70s. And I wouldn't have wanted to work with any younger person. Jackie was the hardest worker, and she was so funny. She kept me rolling. But this is, yes, kids, my kids out there. Yes, I need glasses now. But this is from Pauline. One thing she wanted to just say was that it's very hard for her not to be here right now, but obviously for other reasons, she can't. I always told my mom that she is the best mom I ever could have. And she is, and I say is, because I know she is very much alive in the presence of her Lord. What I think I learned most from her was her kindness. She never had an unkind word to say about anyone. She really loved people for real and enjoyed getting to know people and treating them as if she had known them for many years, just like you said, Ronnie. Your mom did that. It's amazing. When I think of my mom, I also think of how much fun she was. She had such a great sense of humor and even loved laughing at herself sometimes. She loved having fun and was always up for a game of any kind, but she was a fierce competitor and usually won. Yes, and yeah, children just like it. I've played many games with her. Though she came to know the Lord later in life, her faith was always so much a part of who she was and is, and I really loved her for that. Aside from the Lord, she and my dad are the biggest role models for my life, and I miss her every day. Miss you, Mom. Thanks for being the best mom. See you soon. And just on a personal note, you know, my family, Glenn and I and my kids have known, and my mom, she's up there with my mom. You know, they're together. But she just was, when you went to visit her, you left there built up. You left there laughing. You left there knowing that you don't know how to play a game. But she just was truly amazing. And Al, we love you so much. Al is just, you know, the mom and dad just raised such an amazing family. And this is for Pauline. Pauline, this is from your mom. She knows what it means.
Thank you, Lori. Okay, fantastic. Carol Ann, do you want to come up to the stage or down here? Okay. Carol Ann and Diane.
There you go. Do you want to go first?
No.
Well, we're not going up there because Carol Ann has a brace, and I can't walk without my cane. So we're okay. It's temporary. Thank you so much for taking time out to be here. Thank you. You know, anyone talking about their mother could probably talk for hours, but anyway, she was so awesome. She was just her and my dad. I just want to give you a little peek into our life. You know, when we grew up in our home, the only thing I could remember was the peace that we had in our home. And my mom and my dad, we were raised Catholic, but there was something more, because my dad spent so much time in prayer, and he had a relationship with God, and we could feel it in our home. And we experienced their unity, and it was a beautiful, beautiful experience for us, because it was just an amazing life. And as we grew up, my dad was always looking for the Lord, and my mom, they were just an amazing couple. And when the Lord moved in our lives, and, you know, I received Christ in 1973, and I started praying, seek ye first the kingdom of God. I didn't know what I was doing, because I actually got saved reading my Catholic Bible, but it was awesome. So I started praying. My parents, during that time, decided to move. And the neighbor next door went to the Bible Speaks, and she came and knocked on that door. And at the time, I was the only one at the time, you know, who was evangelical. So what happened was I said, I better go, because she's never going to stop knocking on the door. So, because I was going to a coffee house, but, you know, it was slim pickings, you know. So anyway, I went to a Bible study in Southborough, Massachusetts. I'll never forget walking in the door, and the presence of God came down. And so what happened through that, I'm saying this to say that my parents were always so open to the God, and they decided they wanted to come. And my mom, she was so cute, because she was the first person out of the family that came to Bible study. She would go to bingo every Tuesday, and she would, later she told me, I would get so upset with you, because she wouldn't say it, but she would say, it's my bingo night, and you'd ask me to come to Bible study. I started feeling guilty, you know? So it's so cute. But she came, and the night that she came to Framingham, and she received Christ. And from then on, then we prayed for my dad. We didn't know how to pray. And we're like, God, we just pray that he will lose his job so he'll come to a Bible study. Because he was a truck driver. So he did come, and he got saved. So what happened was, wow, after that, they were hot on God's trail, I'll tell you. God didn't have to do much. He just, you know, they moved to Lenox, and they just, beautiful couple serving God. And my mom, I just remember her loving people, loving children, always wanting to minister to the children. You know, she'd slip them a dollar here and there, you know, so cute. And she always opened our home on Christmas and Thanksgiving, you know, because she just wanted to minister to the body, and, you know, people that needed to be with other people that were maybe alone. So, sorry, I'm a little shaky here, but... I'm going to miss her, because she was just the sweetest, kindest, most compassionate person. She, you know, she had dementia, you know, and I'll never forget. I just want to share a couple of things with her.
Were you going to share that thing about Dad the night before? Were you going to share that?
No, I didn't. You can.
Okay. I had to lean on something.
That's a good thing. So, I was concerned about Pauline. And hi, Pauline, I love you. I was concerned about my sister, Pauline and Rick. I was concerned about my sister, so I had a burden, and I just couldn't get rid of it. You know, I went to bed with it, and I got up with it. So I went to get my mom up. She was so cute. There were times she'd say,
Oh, I'm so glad you came. I didn't know if anybody would come to wake her up. She's so cute. And so I got her up, and we were in the restroom and bathroom, and she just looked at me. I didn't say anything to her. I didn't want her to see how I felt. And she looked at me, and she said, "You know, you don't have to worry about Pauline. Everything is okay. She's happy, and God is going to take care of her." And I was like, oh, my gosh. And so that burden just lifted. So God did a lot of things like that with my mom. And I'm just so thankful for her life. She was a real servant to us and loved us with all her heart. And thank you so much. I say again, thank you so much for being here to share it with us.
That's awesome. Okay. I wrote this down because I know there's so much to say about my mom that if I don't write it down, you would be here till 7 o'clock. And also, I was hoping that if I focus on this, I won't cry. But that doesn't work. My mom was an amazing wife and mom, as you're hearing, faithful. She loved my dad all 72 years that they were together. Through good, not so good times, she taught us to laugh and showed us how to love. My mom's life was like a lovely bouquet to all. The fragrance was Christ in the center. And then we were like the flowers around, you know, the spray. I'm adding C and I'm losing my place. Okay. This was a little remembrance I wanted to say that showed my mom for me. When I was about, 8 or 9 years old, I had a very bad, I always did have a bad reaction to poison ivy, where, my eyes were shot and fat and my legs and everything. And if I lived in Bible times, I would have to say, I'm clean. And no one would come around me. No family or friends except my mom. She actually climbed into bed with me, and she would gently pat or gently scratch the areas that were so itchy. And she didn't care. She wasn't afraid of getting it or anything. She just loved me. And that was her life. That was her character, compassion. The last year of caring for my mom, it was a privilege, the privilege of my life. So many of you have complimented Diane and I. Thank you you do an amazing job. You have no idea what a privilege, real privilege, to take care of my mom and taking care of my dad now and then too. Though she had multiple myeloma, which is a type of cancer, God again graciously kept her from any pain for 3 years. The only pain she ever had was an occasional backache that ibuprofen took care of. But she also had dementia, but it didn't have her. The reason I'm saying that is a lot of times people with dementia can become a little bit mean or irritable or whatever, even combative. One time, and I really say only once, my mom said something to me because she was irritated. That was unkind. And I looked at her, I said, "Mom, that was not kind." And she looked at me with big eyes and she said, "It wasn't? I'm sorry." And she never, ever said that again or anything like it. It just amazed me because it was her heart. The dementia didn't have hold of who she really was. It just had a little bit of funny things with her brain. But that's okay. There's so much to say about Mom, the crown she has, that she has to lay at Jesus' feet. Patient, kind, tender, wise, funny, and on. She loved to sing with me. She was generous. The list does not end. My mom is a hero of the faith, a trophy of his grace, and I can't wait to see the beauty of her life displayed in heaven. And it's going to be awesome. Thanks.
That was beautiful. Okay, let's look to the screens, please.
Go ahead.
Oh, Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder.
Keep going. Thy power throughout the universe display,
then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great
look here,
thou
Mom.
Art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Okay.
There's some beautiful history there, isn't there? Amazing, a face of an angel. It's incredible. We're going to close our service with Glenn Simpkins coming up with some closing comments and a prayer. And amazing.
Thank you, sir. Wow. Beautiful service. What a testament to Jackie. It's touching. I'm just happy and blessed that I knew this woman. I'm happy and blessed that I knew Al. And the Bible tells us in Philippians 1, verse 3, I thank God for remembrance of you. So today, everyone here can thank God for remembrance of Jackie. And if you meditate on that reference in Philippians 1, verse 5, there's a writing in verse 5. It says, our partnership in the gospel. Pastor Norton said earlier that Al and Jackie had a unique prayer life. They were prayer saints. They were prayer warriors. I had a partnership with Jackie and Al with the gospel. These two individuals behind the scenes would pray for my ministry to share the gospel to people for specific divine appointments. And only heaven will tell the results of that. I could be here for 24 hours or more and tell you testimony after testimony of unique, unique testimonies that only God can move because of the result of prayer. And I just want to say that it being partners with the gospel and what we heard about Jackie's life, it was a laid down life. It was a servant's life. We heard those words, a laid down life, a servant life. Her heart of kindness, her heart of gentleness, her heart of politeness, her heart of inviting everyone in, lined up in one accord with the Savior, with the gospel. Because the Bible tells us that Jesus didn't come to be ministered to, but he came to serve and to lay down his life for us. So in closing, I would like, there might be one person in here, there may be one person watching online. I want to give you a gospel invite of the gospel. See, our great God, our Lord Jesus Christ, he is Lord God. Philippians 2, 10, 11 tells us that. That one day every knee will bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord. He's the great Messiah. He's the creator of the universe, Colossians 1, 16. He came to this earth with a mission to lay down his life for us. He went to Calvary's cross. He took spike nails in his hands, his feet, a crown of thorns, a bloody mess. Now that blood wasn't merely any man's blood. That was God Almighty's blood. It was sinless, spotless, and pure to atone and pay for your sins, my sins, the sins of the world. He died. They put him in the grave. Death couldn't keep our Lord in the grave. He resurrected the third day. He ascended into heaven. Now, here's the good news of the gospel. He's the one-time sacrifice for your sins, Hebrews 10:10. All you got to do to get to heaven and not go to hell is accept Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Now, I'm going to give a closing prayer. And when I pray, I'm going to give an invite for you to call on Jesus to be your personal Savior. Because the Bible says in Romans 10:13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. All right, all heads bowed, all eyes closed. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for the testimonies we heard. We thank you for the life of Jackie Turmel. And we thank you, Lord, that she knows you personally. We thank you, Lord, that she's walking the streets of gold in Revelation 21 right now. We thank you, Lord, that she's with Jesus. She's with you, Lord, in heaven. We thank you, Lord, for your great and mighty salvation, your great and mighty ministry of a laid down life that was exemplified through Jackie. Lord, we give an invite right now. If you don't know Jesus personally, you need to know him personally. And here's an open invite for you. Just believe the gospel's true, that Jesus is who he says he is. He is God manifested in the flesh. That he had a servant's heart. He laid his life down for you so that you could live. He shed his blood to pay for your sins. He died, was buried, he arose from the grave, ascended back into heaven. All you gotta do, if you believe that's true, is call on him to be your personal savior. The Bible says in Revelation 3:20, behold, the Lord says, I'm at your heart's door and I knock. Right now, he's at your heart's door. If you're hearing this and you didn't receive Jesus, he's at your heart's door right now. He's knocking. Just open it up and let him in. Say this prayer and mean it. Say, dear Jesus, come into my heart and save me. I accept your free gift of eternal life. Now, with all heads bowed and all eyes closed, may we take to heart the life of Jackie Turmel. And we'll remember her today, but I'm guarantee you, 3 months down the road, 5 years down the road, God's going to bring her to your memory. And you know what he wants you to remember? A servant's heart, a laid down life, one that loved the word of God, one that loved the body of Christ, one that loved to seek the lost, one that loved to meet the Lord in prayer and had a very powerful prayer life, one that was gentle, one that was kind, one that was pleasant, one that loved all people and made everyone feel like kings and priests. And when we remember that, may we say, Lord, let me be that to someone right now next to me. Let me be that. And let me be devoted like she was to her husband. They knew each other for 72 years. And devoted to her family. And devoted to the call of God. Lord, we ask these things. We ask that you bless the Turmel family. May they be blessed as they know Jackie is in heaven and she's with the King of Kings. May they be blessed and know that in Hebrews 11:16, that this is not our home. Baltimore, Maryland's not our home. Our real home is with Jesus and with Jackie in glory. And one day we're going to meet them both. So, Lord, we ask that you would bless this family special. We thank you for this ministry. We thank you for the life of Jackie. We ask all these things in the name above all names, Jesus. And they all said, amen.